It's wonderful, but I'm upright and I'm not in a wheelchair and I'm still here, so that's the best I can say. Real quick, a few brief announcements. First and foremost, please pray for Jan. I know he's been sick all week, so, and he is not here. So we are encouraged with Fred speaking with us today. You know, I mean, I had to beg him really hard, and Joanne had to crack the whip on him and make sure he showed up today, right, Joanne? So, okay. But just pray for the family, our church family over there, to make sure that they're doing good. But real fast, Upwards basketball has already started. Our second game in was yesterday. There are still six more opportunities for you guys to be able to help out. If you have a chance to go watch them play basketball, just to sit with a family and encourage their kid, whether you know them or not, that's an awesome opportunity. I know Nancy could use people that would be willing to do devotions on certain nights. I know there's still dates that are open that need help with that. Or if anybody possibly refs, you don't have to know anything. Trust me, we all get trained. We can all learn. I think all the coaches have been covered. But if there's an opportunity, that is a chance for you to come in on your community and just meet new people and greet them and just love on them and just say, we're glad you're here. We're glad to encourage you for, you know, what the kids learn in the program. It's something that they take with them a long, long time. So it's just a great chance. If you have a chance, please text Nancy about that. Ladies, let's go to lunch. January 23rd, this Tuesday. Be meeting at Bellaria in Columbiana for lunch at 12 p.m. If you have children at home, please feel free to bring them as well. Please let Shelly know ASAP if you plan to attend so reservations can be made. Men's Bible study group was yesterday. I think it went well. Ducky, did it go good? And I wasn't able to be there. I apologize. I couldn't do anything. Ducky, I could barely hold my fork to eat, and that is like a tragedy to me. If I can barely eat anything, it's bad. But if you get a chance on Saturdays, every other Saturday, so our next one, February 3rd at 9 a.m., we will meet together, and we just get a chance to sit down and worship together and just look at life and see what life has to offer and what God is presenting to us. We talk about things going on today in the world and how we are going to figure those things out or how God's already solving those problems. People get loud over there. Hey, Fred. Hey. See, they don't even listen. You're loud. Your volume. You are praying. Coming up to February 11th, Sunday, February 11th, 6 p.m., Super Bowl party. Bring a snack and a drink to share and a favorite board game if you don't like football. And coming up this weekend, I have asked a ton of you for help. I have asked a ton of you to donate things, to give me your time, to give me your talent, to give me all your other stuff. Blast is coming up this Friday and Saturday. I will be working on that all week. There's another opportunity. If you want to come in and see some talented kids who really don't get the encouragement sometimes to know that they actually have some talent, come in and watch some of these kids. You know, maybe it's boring to watch table tennis. You know, that's great. That's wonderful. But come see some of these kids sing, play instruments. Friday night at the community center, if you're interested, there's kids that are going to have art. They'll have arts and crafts. We're going to bring all their stuff back here Saturday for them to display here. So we got some multi-talented kids that, you know, when I was 12 years old, I wasn't doing what some of these guys are doing. I mean, and I'm 50 and I can't do what some of these guys are doing still at 12 years old. So if you get a chance, though, it's Friday and Saturday. Friday at the community center, 6 to midnight, and Saturday we'll be here all day, about 9 o'clock till about 3 o'clock. So other than that, want to just say good morning. It's a wonderful day. We're not cracking above freezing today is what they said, but the sun's out. You know, we got, huh? Yeah, that's what I heard. So it's getting warm. It's getting nice. I still hate the snow, but yeah, I'm going to move. I'm going to go to Florida. That's what we're going to do. BJ, we're moving to Florida or something. I don't know. I got to go someplace safe for me that I can't fall. So Dawn, I've been to Dawn's house. Dawn knows that's impossible. I will fall in her floor. So But let's go ahead and open up with prayer and go ahead and start, dear Heavenly Father. We thank you for this day. We thank you for this time together, Lord. We thank you for coming together as a family so that we can worship you in song and as the delivered message, dear Heavenly Father. I pray that you'll just bless Fred. We thank you for his openness to come alongside when we've asked. And I pray that you'll just bless the worship team, dear Heavenly Father, as they bring your message through song. Just continue to give us a time together, a time to be involved in the direction that you want us to be, dear Heavenly Father. Continue to point us in the aim for the community and for each other's lives that you have asked us to be involved in. And I pray for these things in your name. Amen.
Well, it sure is great to see everybody here this morning. I hope you all have come to raise your voices and worship the Lord. Would you please stand as we share God's word with us? We're reading from John chapter 16, verse 33. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. You know, even though there's troubling things that go on around us, when anything has to do with our Lord and Savior, there's something of power, of peace, of comfort, all the things that he promises us. And, you know, he is worthy of our praise that every day we get up, that he gives us the ability and the power and the strength through him that we can go out into this world. We might have trouble. You might have a flat tire. You might have other things going on in your life. But take heart. Take heart. He has overcome it. And one more thing I want to share is, you know, there's so many things that we can feel joy about. You know, last week, Denny and I got to go witness one of our grandchildren get baptized. And, you know, that's a privilege that God has given us, that we get to witness that and celebrate it. And sometimes I don't think that we celebrate those things enough. And so I just praise the Lord for AJ and his sincerity and just so proud that the Lord has worked a great work in him in starting. So join us as we worship the Lord. Let's you know, we're going to be singing Joy in the House. Let's let this house feel filled up with joy this morning. We have every reason to be joyful. Amen.
Shout out your praise. we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. 'Cause we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out.
So thankful for a God who comes no matter how we're feeling, no matter if the weather's bad, He's still here. So I'm so thankful for a God that no matter what, He will get praise, even if it's from the rocks. If we don't praise Him, the rocks will praise Him. So I'm just thankful that we are honored enough to be able to praise our Heavenly Father, and just that He takes the time to be with us, to meet with us. And we are going to go ahead and move on into friendship time. So go ahead and greet one another.
Amen. Welcome to the Goodbye Old Me Workout with your hosts, Consumed by Fire.
Your love is amazing,
steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me.
Sing. Do you have a song in your heart today? This next song we're going to sing is A Good, Good Father. He truly is a good father, isn't he? Yeah. It's amazing that he desires the intimacy with each and every one of us. An amazing thing that he can be intimate with each and every one of us. You know, even when we're just by ourselves, his intimacy is with us. He desires that. I was just sharing with the praise team before we came up here. I was sick the last couple of weeks and still reading my Bible and praying and everything, but boy, there was just something missing. I just felt an emptiness. But, you know, it makes me realize how much we truly need each other. We really do. There is something about that. His presence is so strong when we are together. Where two or three are gathered, there he is also. I would like to just share a scripture, Psalm 23, verse 1. And by his grace, it is possible to believe that he is perfect in all of his ways. It is possible for us. even in our unwanted circumstances, to not want. Because we have all that we need in our good, good Father. I am so thankful that we have a place to come, that we have a holy God that desires that for each and every one of us, that we would come. I don't know what you have to bring today that might be burdening you, but we have a good, good Father that truly desires that you would bring it to him and leave it there at the altar of his feet. Let him have it today and sing with us today, please.
Say a word, you're a good, good Father. us pray. Thank you, Father, for this day. And we just want to thank you for all the blessings that you give to us, Lord. And may we all just have pleasing lives to you as we live out our lives. And you tell us that as is anyone among you suffering, then he must pray. Is anyone cheerful? He's to sing. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. The effective prayer of a righteous man can accomplish much. We just want to thank you for that scripture today, Lord. And we have some prayer requests to lift up to you, Lord. Pray for MJ and her family, how the struggles they're going through right now, Lord. And we just thank you for the joy and the peace that you bring through those situations. And we also pray for Sandy and her family. And we bring Charlotte and Jim and Jan and family. There's so many people with so many needs today. And we also pray for Blast this weekend and all the workers and all the kids that are going to be here. And our main goal is that these kids will recognize just who Jesus really is, how his provisions provide us what we need day to day. And as we go on here, I pray for Fred for his preaching today. And we pray that we bless him and that the words that flow through him will just bless our lives. And we just ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Am I on? Yep, I'm on. Would the ushers like to come? Take up the offering? You always like to do that before you preach because, you know, they're more willing to give a little more after they hear me. I don't know. So, all right. That's my little buddy over there. Will, would you, you pray, please? What? Do you look like a little buddy? Yeah. That's my little buddy over there. You're my big buddy. Okay. All right.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. You give back what is already yours, Lord. May you continue to bless in the continuation of the furtherance of your kingdom. In your name we pray.
Amen. Amen. We have one more prayer request. Jan got a text from Terry Palmer, and she fell and pulled a muscle. And she, the type of person Terry is, she did it last week. She didn't want to put it on a prayer chain and take anything away from MJ and from Sandy. And Terry is such a sweet, sweet person. We've known him for years. And I just, right now, Lord Jesus, we just lift up Terry and Gerald, and be with them and comfort them and the rest of the family and the new granddaughter, Lord. And we pray that they're just able to, she's able to get up and move around and go see that new grandbaby. And Lord, we just pray all this in thy name. Amen. Amen. All right. What time is it? 11:06. Six on the clock here. They got it 1 minute ahead for Jan, but it don't help. It don't help. Okay. All right. This morning it's a, what is God's plan? Oh, I'm sorry. I'm old. I forget. Children, any children that don't want to sit and listen to me, you can go to Children's Church. Dave, sit down. Hunter, don't think about going, you know. That's my adopted grandson there, so. He's one of the ex-Napa boys. All right, so let's get started. When I was preparing for this message today, you know, you don't know how long that pastors spend time searching and praying and, you know, hoping that the message that God's laid on your heart, that it was actually God and it wasn't something else, you know. And so this message today is God's plan for us. And boy, I tell you what, with everything going on in this world, it's just, you know, what Dawn was saying, you know, being away from the church and for a couple weeks, and Joanne and I have been sick off and on, and she had COVID, and then I'd catch a cold, and then I'd get better, and then she'd catch something. It's just, you know, if you put a crack in that door for evil, it'll go wide open if you allow it. And there's times that when you really need a church family and, you know, somebody to reach out to and just be able to talk to them, you know. And that's what's so great about having a family like this and the ones that we've met over the years. All right, so first scripture is Psalms. And this is something... I don't know. I know Bev would probably know that. Psalms. Why do they put a P if it's silent? You know, just because or what? I mean, who would come up with that? It's Psalms. It's not palms. It's Psalms, you know. So I look at that, and every time I look at that, I think, you know, so I'm getting off track, so I don't want to do that. I want to be out here. I want you guys to be out here where you can enjoy your family time and Sunday school. So let's get on with it. For those of you who don't know me, I got a kind of a weird sense of humor. So anyways, amen. Yeah, he used to be one of them stinking teenagers. There's a couple of them sitting in the back row back there and over there and one running the sound. I'm surprised he doesn't shut me off. But I have a lot of stories about Cody. So anything you want to know about the code man, let me know. And when Owen's old enough to understand, I'll tell him about his dad. Okay. All right, let's get going. Psalms 32, 8 through 10. I will instruct you and teach you in the way you should go. I will counsel you with my loving eye on you. Do not be like a senseless horse or mule that needs a bit or a bridle to keep you under control. Many sorrows come to the wicked, but unfailing love surrounds those who trust in the Lord. Boy. It's so hard to determine what that plan is. I look back on my life, and I always said I was kind of a late bloomer in my 40s before I come to know the Lord. And I often wonder how many times that bridle was in my mouth, and the Lord was tugging one way or the other, and I chose to go the other way. And praise be the Lord that... he got a hold of me at the right time in my life, And I'm not going to tell you my story because most of you know it through a neighbor that went to this church, and they reached out, become friends with us, and next thing you know, here I am standing, you know. And boy, what that was a trip I like to tell you about. All right, Proverbs 3:1-6. My child, never forget the things that I have taught you. Store my commands in your heart. If you do this, you will live many years, and your life will be satisfying. Never let loyalty and kindness leave you. Tie them around your neck as a reminder. Write them deep within your heart. Then you will be and find favor with God and the people. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you the path to take. I got a thing in my study Bible here. It talks. It says, in the Old Testament, long life was promised as a benefit of obeying God's word. This was because righteous living is ultimately safer and healthier than sinful life. There are certain exceptions in Scripture of people who are righteous yet died prematurely. Persecution was often the cause of these exceptions. However, the principle obedience promotes blessing generally holds true. Prosperity in the Hebrew is shalom, meaning peace, fulfillment, honor, wealth, was promised to those following God's ways. You know, and in today's world, when we talk about wealth, you know, I always thought that if I had just a little bit more money, maybe I could pay this bill on time, or maybe I could go on a small vacation or do this or do that. You know, and it takes a long time to realize that that's not the kind of wealth that I want, you know. The wealth that I enjoy most is friendship, is peace that the Lord Jesus Christ gives me. No matter where I am, no matter who I'm around, I have a sense of peace. And you can't put a dollar value on that, you know. There's no way, once you have that peace in your heart, that anything would be as much valuable as what that peace is. 2 Peter 3:9-13. The day of the Lord is coming, and boy, I believe that. When you see everything that's going on in this world, you go through Scripture, and it's like, if anybody doesn't believe Scripture, how many thousands of years this book was written, and you can look back and you can start and see the steps of the second coming of Christ. Now, it could be tomorrow, it could be right now, that some of you would be lifted up and I would be left behind, you know. Just to go on preaching, you know what I mean? Just, you know, don't get the wrong idea, Don. But we know that there's so much going on. It talks about falling away from the church. It talks about rumors of wars and poverty and sickness, and it just on and on and on. Not that it hasn't been there years and years ago, because it has. But it seems like it's more prominent in today's world. And you stop and wonder just how long before, I'll put it in simple words, God pulls the plug, you know, and comes in and gets the believers. All right. The day of the Lord is coming. This is Paul. This is a second letter to you, dear friends. And in both of them, I have tried to stimulate the wholesome thinking and refresh your memory. I want you to remember what the holy prophet said long ago and what our Lord and Savior commanded through the apostles. Most important, I want to remind you that in the last days, scoffers will come, mocking of the truth and following their own desires. You can watch that on TV every day. They will say, what happened to the promise that Jesus is coming again? From before the times of our ancestors, everything has remained the same since the world was first created. They deliberately forgot that God made the heavens long ago by the word of his command, and he brought the earth out of water and surrounded it with water. Then he used the water to destroy the ancient world of the mighty flood. And the same word, the present heavens and earth has been stored up for fire. They are being kept for the judgment day when ungodly people will be destroyed. But you must not forget this one thing, dear friends. A day is like a thousand years to the Lord, and a thousand years is like a day. The Lord isn't really being slow about his promise, as some people may think. He is being patient for your sake. He does not want anyone to be destroyed, but wants everyone to repent. But the day of the Lord will come unexpectedly like a thief. Then the heavens will pass away with a terrible noise, and very elements themselves will, and themselves will despair and fire, and the earth and everything on it will be found to deserve judgment. Since everything around us is going to be destroyed like this, what holy and godly lives you should live, looking forward to the day of the God and the hurrying it along. On that day, you will see the heavens on fire and the elements melt away in the flames. But we are looking forward to the new heavens and the new earth as has been promised, a word fulfilled with God's righteousness. Wow. There's so much in those verses there explaining what's going to happen, what we need to do as brothers and sisters in Christ. And one of the most important things we know, Pastor Jan has, you know, preached on numerous times, I preached on when I was preaching, that, you know, to go make disciples. You know, you may not have that second chance to reach somebody, you know. Like Scripture says, you know, it'll come, it'll be like a thief in the night. You know, they talk about, Scripture talks about somebody's out in the field and one will be taken up and the other one will be left. You know, it goes on with different scenarios of different things. You know, and you look around, how many of your family members are lost? How many of your friends? How many of the people that you work with every day that are lost? You know, it's hard to, I don't want to say this, it's hard to reach a family member. You know, for years when I first become a Christian, Joanne and I, and then later on into the ministry, Joanne's family was like, you know, it's a cult. You know, you're in there, you're there. You'd rather be there than you would be at, you know, our house or blah, blah, you know, things going on. And then it wasn't until later on in life that, you know, her mom and dad and sisters and that saw that Joanne and I was serious about this. You know, it made a difference in our life. People saw a change, you know. Scripture also says about, you know, I believe in God, you know what I mean? Well, what did Jesus say? You know, the only way to God is through me, okay? Most people, they took surveys, most people would say, yeah, I believe there's a God. And I was one of them, you know. For them 40 years, I believed, there was never a time that I didn't believe in God, you know. But I never knew, because I wasn't around it, that in order to ever see God, I had to know his son, Jesus Christ, and why his son came to this earth, you know, to take away my sins and your sins, you know, and give us an opportunity to have eternal life. And I was watching a thing on TV, and this one pastor, somebody asked him, you know, is there a hell, you know? And this pastor, you know, he said, well, it's like this. You can have all eternity with our Lord and Savior, or you can have all eternity with Satan, with the devil, with the lake of fire. So it's up to you whether, you know, we're not talking about, I'm almost 72 years old. We're not talking about 72 years. We're not talking about 80 or 90 years, or even people today's world, they live to 100. We're not talking about that. We're talking about all eternity. We can't even fathom that. You know, it's like being able to look up and see the moon. You can't see it. You know it's there, but all eternity is forever and ever and ever. And once that decision is made, that either you're a believer, you've repented, repentance, you want to change your life. I didn't want to be the same as old Fred, okay? Old Fred was a nice guy, very short-fused, you know, but a pretty nice guy. I didn't have probably any enemies, but as soon as I started going to church, You know, I didn't go out and tell, hey, I'm going to the Church of Nazarene. I didn't do that. Joanne and I just started coming with our kids, and they sucked us in. You know? Just kidding. But, you know, we started coming to church, and when Joanne and I come down to the altars and we receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, and we wanted to repent. We wanted to change. Even though we weren't bad persons, we still wanted to change. There were things in my heart or in my life that was displeasing to God, you know, and I know that. And that's what I wanted to change. And all of a sudden, people that I work with noticed that change. He said, man, Fred, what's going on? You know, you used to fly off the handle over this. I, you know, after I learned it's not really worth it, you know. But they started noticing a change. You know, my boss was Roman Catholic, and there's nothing wrong with Roman Catholics. You know, there's going to be a couple in heaven. But no, I told you I have a wrong sense of humor. But no, Catholics are wonderful. They're going to be in heaven the same as Nazarenes and Methodists. And huh? Yep, even the old Baptist, yep. No, but whenever people start seeing a change in you, okay, all of a sudden, you know, out of the blue, somebody would come in, not knowing because I was a new Christian, that God would bring somebody into that plant, whether it would be a salesman or whether it would be another coworker, to come up and talk to me and say, Fred, I hear that you're starting to go to church now. Well, yes, I am, you know. Could you pray for me? Could you pray for my family? You know what I mean? And it was like, I don't even know how to pray for myself yet, you know. But, you know, I go ahead and try. And I know God give me the right words to say. And one day, well, my boss, I'm not saying because he was Roman Catholic, but because he was a boss, there were some people to come in. We had a trailer. That's where I did my computer work. And then I went outside in the warehouse. And one day there was like two or three people, and there was two ladies that worked for us, two secretaries that were also Christians. And so at lunchtime and that, we'd get talking about that, you know. So my boss one day, he said, you know what, there's a right place for everything, and Fred, it's not a right place in this trailer. I said, okay, you know, I don't want to offend him. I liked him very much. He was a good man. I said, no problem, you know. He said, if you want to go outside in the warehouse and they want to talk to you, that's fine. But this is a place of business. I said, okay. Well, about 6 months later, every Thursday, this one vendor would come in, and my boss would go out with them to eat lunch, okay? And the owners of the company, there were two of them. The one was a son, the other one just worked there, but he was their top salesman, so they all three of them would go out to lunch. So they come back, and I could tell there was something wrong with my boss. You know what I mean? He wasn't the same, because they always come back in from lunch laughing, carrying on, everything. Everything was serious. So he come over to me. You know, I'm at my computer going through inventory, and he come to me, and he said, Fred, can I talk to you? I said, Mitch, you can talk to me anytime. You know, he said, no, I need to talk to you in private. I'm thinking, oh boy, what did I do now, you know? So we went outside, and the two salesmen were, the one owner and the salesperson was still another, and they were talking. He come out and he says, I remember it like it was yesterday. He says, you need to talk to John. I said, what do you mean? He said, his wife's pregnant and they're having trouble. She has spina bifida, and they want to take the baby out of her, okay, and do a surgery and put the baby back in her. And he's having a real, real hard time, you know. And my first instinct as the old Fred is, well, 6 months ago, you didn't want me to talk about Christ. Now you want me to go in there and pray with your friend. But I didn't. I said, all right, I said, I'll talk to John. So I told John, that the company was a hydraulic company, and I told him, I said, hey, John, can you come out with me a minute? I said, you know, I got a couple cylinders out there I want you to look at. He said, okay, friend. So he come out, and I brought the subject up, and he started crying, you know, and he said, I don't know what to do. My wife and I, we don't know whether to let the doctor do that. You know, it was an institute somewhere else, you know, high up institute. It was only been like three or four different times it was ever tried, you know. And I said, John, I said, I'm going to tell you something. If this is supposed to happen, it'll happen. You know, if you have faith in God, I said, I know, I said, you were raised partially in the church. I understand that. I said, but you better sit down with your wife and pray about this and find out what God wants you to do. And I talked to him. It seemed like, excuse me, it seemed like hours, but it was only like 10 or 15 minutes. And he really opened up about his life and how important this baby was and everything. And I said, I can't tell you what to do. It's not my place. I said, but what I can tell you to do is I'll pray about it. I'll pray about it, you know, and you have your wife pray about it and see what God wants you to do. So about a week later, following Thursday, every Thursday they come in, he come in and he said, Fred, we decided to go ahead with the surgery. And he said, I hope we're making the right decision. I said, did you pray about it? He said, yes. And every time we prayed, he said, it come up with the doctor and, you know, and I said, fine. So anyways, long story short, they did the surgery. She ended up, it was fine. I can't even imagine taking the baby out of her and doing a surgery on the spine and then putting the baby back in. You know, if that's not a God thing, I don't know what is, you know. But anyways, later on, he showed pictures of me. Later on, she was like the, I can't think of the name of the guy. Jerry Lewis, he had something to do with, you know, she was the poster girl. You know what I mean? And it was like 5-6 years later, you know. And just the joy, when he showed me that article, just the joy in his heart of going through with that, trusting in the Lord, you know. And I mean, that, you talk about having to trust somebody, you know, when it's only been done 2 or 3 times in the world, and this, you know, wherever they went was clear out of state. Those doctors did that, and it's more prominent now, they can do things like that. But it's like, wow, don't ever tell me that there's not a God, you know. Did it make a change in that man's life? Yes. I noticed right away, because they would all come in laughing and, you know, swearing, you know, just kidding each other and that. Well, after that happened, you know, they'd come back from lunch. It wasn't, they were still kind of carrying on a little bit, laughing and that, but never, ever, ever did I hear a bad word come out of his mouth, you know, I mean. And I saw the change in him. And then I could tell you so many stories, and I'm not going to, of how opportunities God has given me to put people in my lives, you know. And you look back now and think, you know, I was talking to my son, and we were talking about different things and that, and I said, boy, I don't know, Paul. I said, if I made the right decision, if God really called me to preach, or if it was just something that I got caught up in, you know. And my son doesn't go to church right now, you know, and I know he was saved because I was there when it happened with about 25 other teenagers. And but he's fallen away. And, you know, all of a sudden you get caught up in making money. And then when you marry somebody that's not a Christian, you know, like, you know, Christ said, don't yoke yourself to an unbeliever. He has, and she's a sweetheart, and he loves her, and she loves him, and, you know, I witness as much as I possibly can, but it's like, Dad, I know, you know, I know, you've preached, you know, my whole life almost, you know, I know, you know, and you want to shake them, you want to shake your family or friends, say, yeah, well, if you know, why aren't you doing something about it, you know? Well, we can't find a church. I said, have you ever looked? He said, well, no. I said, well, then how do you know you couldn't find a church? It was up in Akron, you know. And I said, there's churches. I said, you want me to come down some Sunday, your mother and I come down, and we'll start looking at different churches, helping you along. Well, no, you know. If it's supposed to be, it'll be, you know. And I pray for him, because, and his wife especially, because he's not getting any help from her, you know, because she was, I wouldn't say she was raised Catholic, but her family's Catholic, but they haven't gone to church probably in 40 years, you know what I mean? So she doesn't get any help from her parents, you know? And what I'm trying to say is that God's plan for us, all right? Before we were born, can you imagine? He knew he had a plan for us, you know? How many can say this, I am in the will of God? I know exactly what I want to do. I want to know exactly what God wants me to do. and I want to follow that. Well, a lot of us, including myself, a lot of times I struggle with that, you know, because I retired from pastoring early at 62. And it's like, man, oh man, did I do what God wanted me to do? And He knew my heart. He knew from the time I first hired in a steel mill, it was always 30 and out. You got 30 years in, you could get a full pension, and that was on my mind, you know what I mean? Or 62, you could draw your Social Security. You know, I'm done working. Well, I'm almost 72, and I'm still working. I've retired three times, you know what I mean? And it's like, God, am I in your will right now? And when Brother Jan, you know, or where is he at? Little Wilbur. There he is. Little Wilbur. He called me up, and whenever he says, hey, Freddie, I got a question. I know. I said, what's that? He said, well, you know, the board, I was talking to them, and Pastor Jan's sick, and, you know, we need somebody to fill in, you know. And before, I would say, I'd tell Jan, well, if you can get somebody else, I really get nervous up here. You know, I can't, if you can see how big my font is, you know. When you're old, you know, you even though it's on the back screen there, forget that. Fred's got to have it right here. Because if I look there and look back, I'm lost. I'm old, you know. So I really get nervous about when Jan would ask me. I said, Jan, if you can find somebody else like Sue. Sue's good, you know. She doesn't get nervous. She just comes up here, man, and just wings and, you know. But I said, when Will asked me, and I already had it in the back of my mind that, you know, that Jan was sick or Jan needed a break, and, you know, I wanted to do, and God laid it on my heart, this, that I needed to do this, you know. So, God has a plan for each and every one of us. And I pray that each and every one of us is open to that, because that's what it is. We're open to that. You know, there are so many worldly things that are tugging on our hearts every day. You know, just, you know, finances, internet. I mean, good. I mean, anything. I know they got a bug in my house, because if I think of something, it's on Facebook. You know what I mean? And it's like, I've come to the point where I'm about ready to throw Facebook in the whole cell. If it wasn't for having to have a cell phone for work, I said, I'd pitch it. Because I am just so sick and tired. It's like everybody's spying on you. And it's, and most of the stuff on Facebook, you know, you see something that's really sincere, and you click on it to share it, and then somebody says, that's a scam. You know, it's like, how do I know it's a scam? How do you know it's a scam? You know what I mean? Well, it was on Facebook 7 years ago. You know, it's like, I haven't even been on Facebook 7 years ago. How do I know? But there's scammers out there. Even something as precious as life. You know, pray for this person or this child, you know. I'm praying for them. And I want to share it, you know. Then they come up and say it's a scam, you know. This world is sick. Really and truly, it's sick. And there's just things going on that's out of our control. But God knows everything, and He knows our hearts. And even though there's times when you or I would not go, would have to have that bridle or that bit, you know, to tug on, you know, it's like, man, I don't want to do it. My first church, I did not want to get up and preach. I mean, okay, they hire you as a pastor. What are you going to do? I'll mow the grass, you know? It's like, but no, you're going to preach. So I get up, you know, and I'm going to share a story how God has a sense of humor. He had to. Look at me. Anyways, my first church was in Clinton, Ohio, and I went down and I interviewed, you know, and they accepted me, and had a hard enough time getting Joanne to move down there, to leave her home and go down there to, what'd you used to call it, Joanne? You don't want to know. Okay, all right. I'm sorry. Okay, I forgot about that, you know. But anyways, it wasn't the most desirable place. You know, the church had been flooded two or three times. There was a pastor there before me. It was young guns, and all of his family come there, and the church grew and grew and grew, and whenever he wanted a new church and they wasn't willing to do it, he left. Well, then all of his family left, and there's like 15 people. So for probably over 2 years, they had an interim pastor that would fill in there on, say, 9:30 service, and then go from Clinton to Canal Fulton, which was 10 minutes away, and they had the same problem. So when I went down there and applied, they were just happy to get somebody, you know, anybody to fill the slot. But my prayer was, God, you know, I need my wife to go with me. My dad was living with me at the time. I need my, because I mentioned to my dad, he said, just get me an apartment in East Liverpool close to the doctor. I'm not going. You know, that's the only place I go, the doctors. You know. So I said, all right. And Joanne didn't want to go, naturally. And so my first Sunday there, you know, you talk about nerves. I don't know if any of you have ever filled in. If you have a boss, if you ever had to fill in for your boss, and it's like, oh, man, you know, I see what he did all the time. But actually sitting in his seat and filling in and trying to make the right decisions and that, it was like, that's like preaching, you know what I mean? And so it's like, finally I come in, they announce me, you know, and I come in. And my prayer to the Lord was, please make it a contemporary church, Lord Jesus. You know, we didn't sing that many hymns. I don't know. Don't you know this hymn, Pastor? No. You know? Well, what do you mean? You know? No. I said, I don't. We didn't sing a lot of hymns in the church, and I never become a Christian until I'm 40 years old, you know? So when I go to that church, guess what? Yep. It wasn't contemporary. It was a traditional church, you know, and it was all hymns. And the first Sunday wasn't bad enough. Well, I'm not saying bad enough that I had to preach, but I had to sing in the, and because there was only two people. Okay, we had two singers and a piano player. So they said, can you sing? I said, hear this voice. Do you think I can sing? Oh, come on, you know. So like the Saturday before Sunday, I come out up to church, and we start going over these songs. And I do not know these songs, you know. And, you know, the piano player was a sweetheart, and she said, Pastor Fred, you don't, I said, I come from a contemporary church. It's more kind of like, you know, the uplift, you know. And not that hymns are bad because they're good, but I don't know them, you know. Well, just follow along, you know. We need another voice up there, you know. Oh, boy. So I start singing, you know. Nobody left, so that was a good thing. So I start singing, and then I had to preach. We had a pulpit like this, but it was enclosed, and I, as God is my judge, my knees were knocking together like this. And it's like, you know, did I prepare long enough? Do they want to hear that? All these thoughts, or negative thoughts, are going through your mind. And then I looked up, and they had a balcony up in the back, like years ago, probably a choir was up there or something. Big round picture of Jesus Christ. It was a stained glass. And I'm here, and I'm thinking, I'm getting ready to start, and my legs are knocking. You know, I'm thinking, oh, Lord, what I get myself into. And I looked up, and I saw that, and upset, just a sense of peace come over me. And I was able to get through that sermon and 3 years of sermons there. But it's like, God will never leave your side. And he's always, if he's not beside you, he's in front of you. And he was leading that way. He knew at that time, the people in that church needed somebody like me, you know what I mean, and to kind of pick up things and just love them, because that's what most churches need. They just need love. They need somebody that they can love also. And it was a great church. But I just want to say that spend time in God's Word. I've spent more time now than I think I've ever have. You know, not because I'm scared of the end times. I'm not scared of being taken up, but I'm scared for friends and family that don't know the Lord, you know. And I know in my heart that when I go to heaven, that I'm not going to say, where's Joanne? I'm not going to say that. You know what I mean? I'm not going to know that she's not there. You're not going to know of the loved ones, because there's no pain in heaven. You know what I mean? So I'm not going to know, you know, unless I hear somebody gabbing. You know what I mean? And then I'll look around. I know she's up here, you know. But to those who we don't know the Lord, that's what tugs on my heart, you know. Have I been a good disciple? No. You know? Do I go out every day and hunt somebody down and, you know, and witness to them? No. But one thing I've always tried to do is that I try to represent God as much as I can in my walk, treating people fairly, you know, being fair with people. I've worked in places where, you know, including the mill, that there were many, many, many non-Christians that didn't want nothing to do with it, you know. And you know, you, like the scripture says, you plant a seed, you know, God will water it, you know. He'll give it enough sunshine for it to grow, you know. But your job is not to worry about that. Your job is just to go out and plant that seed in someone and start seeing the changes in their life. And then after you plant that seed, be there for them, because they're going to have questions. You know, I did, you know, and I was lucky enough that when I received Christ in this church, that I had a church family here that when I started, you know, maybe kind of like going the other way a little bit, there was somebody there to grab a hold of me and say, come on, let's go to lunch. Let's do this. Let's do that. Call me on the phone. Hey, how's your week been, Fred? You know, cool. You know, I'm thinking about something else. And then all of a sudden somebody calls and says, hey, how have you been? You know, and it makes all the difference in the world. That's why we have this family of God, you know. And like Don said, he was away a couple weeks and he missed it. You can watch us online, you know, and what's nice about online that you can just turn me off, you know. Here, you got to pay attention to what I'm saying. But online is fine. When we had COVID, it was fine. But it wasn't the same. Even when we come to the parking lot and sat out in our cars and turned our radio on, it wasn't the same, you know? You need to be around other believers. You need to draw strength from them. They need to draw strength from you, you know, so that we don't get off of that pathway that the Lord has provided for us. So that's all I got to say, and I went longer than I thought I would. And Jan will be proud of me because he said, don't go up with a 10-minute sermon, Fred. Come on now. Give me a break. You know? No, just kidding. So if you'd please bow your heads. Heavenly Father and Lord, we come to you with humble hearts. We want everybody that we know that we meet to know you as we know you. Give us the right words to say, Lord, the right actions, not to become of the world, but become more and more of you and your will that you have for each and every one of us. Lord, again, we lift up all the prayer requests in the church. MJ and the family, I was there Thursday, and Lord Jesus, just continue being with them. Wrap your arms around them and give them a sense of peace right now. Be with Sandy and Ray and the family. Sandy was in Salem Hospital, and Lord, you know the things that she's been through, but yet her faith is even stronger now than it was before. Please continue being with them. And Terry and Gerald, Lord, we lift them up. They ask that you continue with her, that her torn muscle heals, that she's able to get up, at least help herself to get up instead of Gerald having to lift her and possibly hurt his back. Please be with them. Be with Jim and Charlotte, Lord Jesus. What a lovely couple's been in this church for years and years, and you're just special to each and every one of us here, Lord Jesus. Be with Jim in the home, nursing home, and be with Charlotte as she's home, and I know she's worrying about Jim and with her own illnesses, and be with her. Lord, we pray again for Pastor Jan and Shelley and the family to be with him, give him the strength that he needs, Lord, to overcome this cold or flu or whatever he has, to be with him and to give him the strength he needs to carry on your will that you have in his life for him. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. And we pray as the Lord has instructed us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, Lord, for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. All right. It was nice talking to you. Yeah, I'll be here next Sunday, but I'll be sitting in that seat over there, you know. Thank you.